a wild day of free agency day one. KD goes to the East. We wait for Kawhi. Let's get right to the hot topic section here, Teddy. Interesting day, nonetheless. Durant, as we say, goes to Brooklyn. Iggy shipped off to Memphis. So we see that dynasty sort of downshift out there in Golden State. Taking a look also at some odds shifting as we speak. These were taken directly off of DraftKings out of New Jersey. The Lakers plus 300, the Bucks plus 600, and the Raptors plus 800. A lot of that, Teddy, can change with that Kawhi Leonard decision due shortly.
Yeah, but I mean, Kawhi, just one piece of the puzzle that needs to fall into place. There's a ton to talk about here. Obviously, Brooklyn, the biggest story on the opening night of free agency. Guess what? You know, they've got a super team now and will be priced accordingly. So when you talk about point spread bargains, future bargains, the Nets have the star power for New York. Of course, the Knicks don't. We have to laugh at the Knicks for a minute. Yeah, let's tank. Let's trade Porzingis. Let's do everything we possibly can to create cap space and get a high draft choice. And, oh, we didn't get the top two picks. And we didn't get any free agencies. Julius Randle, the big addition for the New York Knickerbockers. They, too, are likely to be lined, what, in the 20-something win range again this next year. The team that I was impressed with, and I had sneaky good moves, Indiana. The Pacers have made themselves into legit Eastern Conference contenders over the course of the last couple of weeks. I like just about everything they've done, and they're not a team that the markets appear to be particularly excited about. Jimmy Butler to the Heat, I didn't see that coming, Donnie, did you? Miami trying to get the superstar, what they probably need for a team that's been languishing in that 7 or 8 spot in the East ever since LeBron and company, or LeBron in particular, left town. Milwaukee's the last team I want to talk about here. The Bucks lose Brogdon, pay Middleton, pay Lopez. I agree with paying Lopez. I do not agree with paying Middleton over Brogdon. You ask me which of those two guys I'd rather have for the next 5 years? It's not even close. I'll take the young guy with the upside, not the jump shooter in Middleton. But Milwaukee chose to pay the veteran and let Brogdon walk. I wonder if that's a move they'll regret somewhere down the line.
Yeah, also Mirotić bounces out and goes over to Europe, which changes a little bit of the landscape. But you did talk about, you know, D'Angelo to the Warriors now in a sign and trade, Jimmy Butler to the Heat, which was kind of interesting there. Al Horford just over the Sixers. It's a wide open race. It's actually going to be a lot of fun, Teddy, talking NBA next year, because it looks like unless Kawhi goes to the Lakers and they, you know, shift in a couple of these mid-level exceptions, guys on their severely short contracts, that they could make a run at it. Seems like the NBA is set up for a lot of fun. And you're right. Let's talk about the New York Knicks here. How many years have we seen it now, Teddy? It has to be at least going on a decade now. The Knicks are freeing up spots. Everybody wants to come to New York. Who wants to play at the Mecca? And they struck out on LeBron twice, KD twice. It just seems like they're not going to get anybody in here. And also, we're not talking about like clearing spots the last few minutes, Teddy. We're talking about max level exceptions that they've had sitting and waiting, and they can't even get an actual meeting with some of these top name free agents. So as the world turns here in the NBA, we're waiting on Kawhi. We'll keep you updated right here on that betting show at sportsbookreview.com. But interesting day nonetheless. How about another interesting weekend, we should say. Historic run support over there in London. 50 runs scored, Teddy, between the Boston Red Sox and the New York Yankees in the London series. 65 hits, 16 doubles, and 10 home runs. This wasn't a 5-game series, Teddy. This was a quick weekend jaunt over the over to London.
Yeah, I mean, look, the over was as high as 16.5 for Sunday's game. That's the highest MLB total I've ever seen, ever. And 4-2 after six, heck, the first five under cash, no problems. But the big innings were really big all weekend. There were 7 half innings in the two games with 4 runs or more scored, including some whoppers, a 9-run inning, a 6-run inning. But when you have 7 half innings in two games, when you're scoring 4 runs or more, you're going to cash some over tickets. Bettors did that all weekend if you were playing the Yankees and the Red Sox in London. The warm weather certainly has something to do with it. So did the short fences. And bottom line, over bettors cash, despite it being the single highest total I've ever seen for a major league game.
Exactly. And also, you're looking in the seventh inning like, hey, man, got a pretty nice under going on here. And the change in the matter of minutes. You were talking to the pitchers there. The ball sounded different when it was hit. It was just traveling farther. And the one criteria that you said, you know what, Teddy, which we talked about previous, how you could possibly keep this game under was the foul ground territory. We saw maybe one or two balls, but a lot of times, Teddy, these guys were running, looked like a mile to get after that ball, and it still landed in foul toward territory where they couldn't make the catch. So just an interesting series. But Major League Baseball says it was a success. Obviously, sold out stadiums there. You bring two of the bigger name teams over shores. They want to certainly milk to other continents now to play some regular season games. But that was an interesting one over the weekend, getting all of those runs. How about this one, Teddy? You want to talk about getting all those runs in London? Let's downshift over to Max Scherzer, who barely anybody getting any runs on. 8 innings, 1 earned run, 14 Ks back in Motown. He was absolutely sensational. Sensational for the entire month. One of the best free agent pitcher signings that you're ever going to see. And how about those Tigers, Teddy? You want to talk about having problems? Most people say, you know what? Struggling on the road. Let's get back home and win some games. They've won 3 of their previous 25 home games.
Yeah, that is a rough record. As for the Nationals, look, I went out last week. I don't bet a lot of futures. I bet Nats to win the division. I bet Nats to win the National League. I bet Nats to win the World Series. I do think they're alive for a real run. And Scherzer's performance yesterday tells us why they're alive to make a real run. A team that struggled mightily over the first half of the campaign in all kinds of different ways has seemed to have found their mojo and now back above a 500. As for the Tigers, their last 8 home series, they played Houston, Oakland, Tampa, Minnesota, Cleveland, Texas. That's the top 2 teams in the AL East, the top 2 teams in the AL Central, and the top 2 teams in the AL West. And they also had Miami. They're not supposed to get swept by Miami, but they did. And Washington at home. So 7 of the 8 teams that they faced were quality foes. That being said, 3-22 at home. If this is a streak you caught early, you're living the good life right about now. Unfortunately, at 3-22, you wonder how much value still holding. Then again, I bet there's a lot of bettors that don't even know that the Tigers are 3-22 in their last 25 games. The betting markets don't seem to take trends like this very seriously.
Absolutely. On those Nationals that we're taking a look at, Teddy, look, man, 3 really good pitchers at the top of the lineup. At the top of the rotation, they hit with that lineup. They can find a bullpen piece or two around that trade deadline. That might be something worth striking gold with as the rest of the season goes on. Now, Teddy, look, we turn the calendar today. Did you notice the top of the show today? July the 1st, another month closer to college football season. Today on That Betting Show, we're going to take a look at a top 20 football preview. Those Oregon Ducks. How about this, Teddy? 33-1 to win the 2019 NCAA title. The win total is at 9 plus 120. And we talk about head football coaches, what they do best. Mario Cristobal coming out of that Miami cloth through Alabama. He's a great recruiter. His best recruiting job, not getting a 5-star athlete, getting the quarterback to stay next year in Justin Herbert. He's back. A lot of Ducks are going to be coming back to this season as well. Top 2 running backs, a couple wide receivers coming back to play. Also set up with a big SEC tilt, Teddy, August 31st, down in Jerry World.
Sure, and there's a fair bit of hype around the Oregon Ducks this year, and it has everything to do with Herbert, a guy who could have been potentially the number 1 overall draft choice, who came back to play for his senior season, and he's going to be working behind an offensive line with more than 150 career starts between them. You know, 4 returning starters, 4 four-year starters on the offensive line, and then another senior with the tackle spot on the right side. So, this team loaded up front, and a QB who can make plays with his feet and make plays with his arm, and a QB who's saying all the right things. Quote, we're not going to let outside pressure affect us. We're not going to worry about what anyone else is saying. We're just going to focus in-house and worry about what we have to say. You talked about the skill position talent. Look, they can run the football. Yeah, they lost Dylan Mitchell, but no question, they've got a strong receiving core, new receiving coach, former Utah State assistant Javon Booknight, who was supposed to instill discipline in that unit. I do have concerns about Oregon, big concerns on the defense side of the football. They brought on Andy Avalos from Boise State, throwing Jim Leavitt out the door. Couple of third-year starters at cornerback. Strong safety. I like the secondary. I do not love this front 7. I wonder where the pass rush is going to come from. I think you might be able to run the football against Oregon. And this, one of these little things you want to pay attention to, they're hoping their true freshman, Camden Lewis, can be their kicker and maybe their punter, which means when it comes to special teams units, the kicking and punting games, when you talk about hoping the freshman can do them both, that's a concern for me. And when you talk about a team that's having big hopes, talking about winning conference titles and ranked in the top 15 and all of that. All it takes is a bad punt or a missed field goal at the wrong time, and all those hopes come crashing down. I worry about Oregon's special teams. I worry about their defense. They're not a team I'm looking to bet over the total, despite the success and the potential of Justin Herbert on the offensive side of the football.